Hello, okay. All right, good morning, everyone. My name is Alexis Holmes, and I serve as the SGA Senior Class President. I would like to welcome you all to the Frederick Douglass Convocation. The theme of this convocation is Black Student Magic. This is important as HBCU students because it's important for us to know about our history and our upbringing. So next, we'll have Invocation by Reverend Bernard Kills, the University Chaplain.
Good morning. Will you pray with me? Oh God, you are the Spirit of abundance, the God of grace. We come this morning to remember those stories that are all around us, stories so often passed over. This day, oh God, we celebrate our stories, a history that belongs to all of us, a history told by our ancestors. May we realize that we too will one day become ancestors to those who remember our stories. We pray now for the history makers assembled here this morning. We know that our story can only be told when we as a people make choices for our future. Give those full of fear hope, O God. May our voices not be hardened by the pain that is all around us. There are many beautiful stories yet to be told, gathered in this very place. May they be boldly told to those who struggle with the man or woman they see in the mirror. O God, widen our history that is shared this month so that day by day, month by month, year by year, it may be known as our history. For we ask in the matchless name of the one who abides and has abided during these 400 years, a history often told with agony and pain, but history that leads to freedom and self-awareness. Amen.
Thank you, Reverend Kills. Now we'll have greetings by Dr. Kevin Banks, the Vice President of Student Affairs.
Good morning. Is everybody okay? Good morning and happy sesquicentennial to all faculty, staff, students, and alumni, as well as my colleagues on the stage here and our keynote speaker, Dr. Jared Ball. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you at this time. I would be remiss if I didn't let you know that Dr. Wilson wishes that he could be here this morning, but he is out doing what he does best, and that is advocating and championing the mission of Morgan State University. You know, not a day goes by that I'm not reminded of the greatness that Fair Morgan has produced. Just this past Sunday, the greatness of Morgan was showcased on the world stage during the pregame ceremonies of the Super Bowl. Did anybody see that? Did anybody see the Super Bowl? Come on, man. How many of you saw our four NFL Hall of Famers that were honored? Come on. How did it make you feel when you saw our MSU Bear logo on the TV screen? That was international. That was against the whole world. Everybody saw that. And then how about our Super Bowl commercials? No, I'm not talking about that Mr. Clean commercial. No. I'm referring to the commercial titled Inside These Lines. The visuals depict a crew preparing the field for a game, followed by images of players and fans overcoming differences and banding together all inside these lines. Well, believe it or not, the music soundtrack for the commercial was written by Morgan's very own Lonnie Liston Smith, a well-renowned jazz artist. And then, finally, believe it or not, there was a Morganite playing in the Super Bowl. Number 52, Elandon Roberts, was a freshman at Morgan State University. He was all MEAC academic and all MEAC performance. And he played 1 year at Morgan, and unfortunately, you know, he transferred to a school back in his hometown of Texas, and I don't want to talk about that. But Morgan's thumbprint was all over that experience, and it shows the greatness of our university. So you should all be feeling really proud about that. I say all to remind you that we are part of greatness and excellence, you are all part of greatness and excellence, whether you like it or not. You know, a famous football coach said, perfection is not attainable, but if we chase perfection, we can catch excellence. And I say to you, each and every one of you, let's keep chasing excellence, because that's what Frederick Douglass did, that's what Harriet Tubman did, that's what Martin Luther King did, that's what Earl Graves did, that's what the late Senator Verda Welcome did, Len Ford, Roosevelt Brown, Leroy Kelly, and Willie Lanier. And guess what? Even our own mayor, Catherine Pugh, did that. So if they can do it, why can't each and every one of you? Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Banks. Now we'll have by the Morgan State University Choir.
Good morning. Seems appropriate during this Frederick Douglass convocation during Black History Month, we're going to sing two spirituals. First, our first selection this morning will be an incredible arrangement of the spiritual Steal Away. Thank you.
Thank you to the Morgan State University Choir. Next, we'll have our introduction speaker, who is the Student Government Association President, Ms. Joy Jolene Griffin.
How is everyone today? Are we good? Are y'all up? Y'all seem really tired. I know the snow. You good? Good. That's great. That's great to hear. So I am Joy Jolene Griffin, Student Government Association President. Good morning, Morgan State University, the national treasure, the home of deep and rich African American history, where we take pride in our orange and blue. African Americans have always been hidden figures and will always be magic. Some that we are familiar with and some that we are unfamiliar with. Our illustrious university especially. Roosevelt Rosie Brown Jr. was an American football offensive lineman in the National Football League for the New York Giants from 1953 to 1965. Monique was born in Baltimore, Maryland. She is the youngest of four children. Monique graduated from Milford High School in Baltimore County and attended Morgan State University. She is a 1987 graduate of the Broadcasting Institute of Maryland and now a prominent actress in our community. Your black is magic. In a world that beats us down, we must build each other up because we have become our own defenders. And we are in charge of keeping our rich history alive. I will not name all of our brothers and sisters that have lost their lives in our fight, but rather challenge you to step into their shoes and imagine the amount of bravery and courage it took for them to fight against a system that was made to break us down and control our people. Most protests and sit-ins began with college students. Morgan students in particular. Your black is magic. Currently, Maryland faculty, alum, and staff have come together to form a coalition and sue the state of Maryland, for the state of Maryland has neglected and devalued its historically black colleges and universities and has been convicted of violating the Constitution in recent court hearings. This could be the next Brown versus Board of Education case, and our voice matters. Yes, we are magic, but we are not inferior. Yes, we are magic, but we are not to be looked over. Yes, we are magic, but we are not to be oppressed peoples. It is now our turn to be our generation's leaders. I challenge you all to seek the magic within and be who your God has destined you to be. Thank you. I will now introduce our keynote speaker, Dr. Jared A. Ball. Dr. Jared A. Ball is a father and husband. After that, he is currently a tenured associate professor at Morgan State University in the School of Global Journalism and Communications and holds a master's degree in Africana Studies from the Africana Studies and Research Center at Cornell University and a PhD in Media Studies from the University of Maryland at College Park. Dr. Ball served a 4-year sentence in the United States Navy and is a veteran of Desert Storm. He has worked as a correspondent, host, and producer for Pacifica Radio, is the founder of Free Mix Radio, and the application of the philosophy of emancipatory journalism to the hip-hop mixtape, and has had his articles, commentaries, and interviews published in all forms of media throughout the world. He is the author of I Mix What I Like, a mixtape manifesto, and co-editor of A Lie of Reinvention, correcting Manning Marable's Malcolm X. And without further ado, I would like to introduce, please give him a warm welcome. Thank you.
Are the ones who are going to have to fight. We used to say, which side are you on? Which side are you on? The truth is, we're in so much debt that the only way out is revolution or war. So now the question is, which side are you on?
Which side are you on, boy? Which side are you on, no matter? Which side are you on, boy? Which side are you on?
See, before I draw the line, let me welcome you close to all the folks who need a bomber, so the people are hopes. Gave the money to suckers while our community still poor. Withdrew the troops but started another war. Colonizing, terrorizing, creating the oil crisis, so they can make a killing on food and gas prices. Prisons are spiraling, trying to lock up the future. Militarized borders and control of computers. Rolling stupid, bumping music that ain't healthy for the shortest. Privatizing schools and policemen in the hallways. Can't be dormant out of work. Rise up, be ready, brought the family with us, and we hold the machetes.
Riding the fence, too many people be riding the fence. Yeah, you say you're ready for war, but are you convinced? I'm not convinced. If you the ride of freedom, fighter, proud, excited, then let's do this. We can make a big united middle finger to the U.S. Give me the bravest and the truest, fuck the hippest and the coolest. We can spark this revolution, and cross this off our to-do list. Put your foot down if you look down on this criminal system. We can put down and get shook down like my niggas in prison. They'll be condemning and condoning their actions in one sentence. Make up your mind and choose your side. Is you a patriot or a menace to society? So riot or sit by quietly. But don't put out your flag and try to say you gon' ride with me. You flip flopping like hip hop. I don't get locked in that trick box. Get caught like Big and Pop. It's got to stop. I am the people, not the big. I repeat after Fred. So please blow my brains out if I ever forget.
I'm with the thinkers. I'm down with the movers in the checkers and the ex-handy drinkers. The non-smokers, the health advocates, the non-voters, the young bloods in the hood. Training like soldiers, I'm on the side of the tracks with the hood guards. The little child that no color inside the margins. I don't ride the fence, I cultivate my strength. Cause if it ain't about power, it don't make sense. I've been down with Boogie Down since BBC Brown Pride. Black power make Bobby change. The OG told me choose battles rising. In the struggle, don't forget your children and your wife. If you wanna see me, you wanna hold me in the kitchen. Every day I put my every action is teaching me. Revolution is a process, it's not a speech or a panel. You fight off early, you can handle it.
Swords, old palace crown with waves, your lords, the side word. one sickness, one cure, one love, one blood, one blood, one war.
Good morning. I know we do better than that after that. I just wanted to start with that. I don't know how well you could hear the words, but I just wanted, I hope the vibe conveyed, because in this moment, we do have to be deciding what side are we on. Are we going to be for freedom? Are we going to be for fascism? Are we going to be for liberation, for just one group of people, or for everybody? And I want to encourage particularly young students that you spend the next 4 years, 5, 6 years of your life asking yourself that question and taking the wonderful opportunity that you have while you're here at Morgan State University to investigate not only what is encouraged in your classrooms, but beyond that, and investigate what's happening in the world and what your relationship to that world is and how we can make improvements. I do want to thank Morgan State. I want to thank, of course, the senior class presidents and vice presidents and organizers for inviting me. I definitely want to thank Reverend Keels and Dr. Banks. It's always a pleasure and an honor and a privilege to get to speak with my colleagues and my campus and my peers and students. All right, so I only have a few minutes. Let me keep it moving here. I just threw this up here, you know, because Colin Kaepernick has been inspiring me lately. And I just found some old pictures, you know, back when I had hair. You know, I've been Colin Kaepernicking for my, you know, for like 25 years, you know. I don't know if you have where you can see it, but anyway. But I think in that sense, Kaepernick has done a great thing in extending and asking himself this question I'm asking us to consider: which side are we on? He took a side, and we'll see to what extent he is punished for that, but it's an important one.
What have you learned from your students, if anything?
What I've learned from my students is that students today are completely full of shit. That is what I've learned from my students, is that much like the generation before them, the only thing they are really interested in is you telling them how right they are and how good they are. That is the same mentality that basically forces Harvard to give out B's to people that don't deserve them out of the fear that they'll go to other schools that will give them B's and those schools will make the money. We live in a country that seems to be just in this massive state of delusion where the idea of what you are is more important than you actually being that. And it actually works as long as everybody's winking at the same time. When one person stops winking, you just beat the crap out of that person, and then they either start winking or they go somewhere else. But it's like, yeah, my students just, all they want to hear is how good they are and how talented they are. And they're not really, most of them aren't really willing to work to the degree to live up to that.
I couldn't help but put that clip in. I hope you could hear that. Branford Marcellus, this legendary saxophone musician, jazz musician, is asked, what does he feel about his students? And even a legend is having trouble conveying to students what they need to know or what they need to hear, because they are encouraged to believe that they are just to be told that they're good and be told that they are deserving of something without work, but not really wanting to put the effort into achieving it. Now, when I usually show this to my students, I add one caveat to this, one other piece to this, that it's not just students that are full of it, that all of us are complicit to a certain extent in producing students
that aren't inspired enough to achieve based on a certain level of effort and just want to be handed something, because in part, American education is designed to pass people along so that they will get to a certain standard or station in life that they are meant to hold. But that's different than what we're trying to do here, which is trying to elevate people beyond imposed structures and stations. But I want to show you something else that I think is a complement to what Marcellus is saying as to why the system of education produces students like the ones he's complaining about, because I certainly don't want to be complicit in just the all too often desire for adults and grown folks and educators to just complain about the youth that come into their classrooms without taking the requisite responsibility for helping maintain structures that produce students. In fact, it's ridiculous to assume that any society is at all struggling or failing because of its youth. That's backwards.
Albert Einstein once said, "Everybody's a genius. But if you judge a fish by its ability to climb a tree, it will live its whole life believing that it is stupid." Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, today on trial we have modern day schooling. Glad you could come. Not only does it make fish climb trees, but also makes them climb down and do a 10-mile run. Tell me, school, are you proud of the things you've done? Turning millions of people into robots, do you find that fun? Realize how many kids relate to that fish swimming upstream in class, never finding their gifts, thinking they are stupid, believing they are useless? Well, the time has come, no more excuses. I call school to the stand.
He's an ancient institution that is out there in disusage. So, Your Honor, this concludes my opening statement. And if I may present the evidence of my case, I will prove it. Exhibit A, here's a modern day ball. Recognize it? Here's a car from 150 years ago. Big difference, right? Stay with me. Here's a car from today. And here's a car from 150 years ago. Big difference, right? Well, get this. Here's a classroom of today. And here's a class that used 150 years ago.
Thank you.
One thread I just want to take in that in a few minutes I have left is the thread that schools have intentionally been designed to kill our ability to dream and to imagine. And a lot of what we do here in Oregon is try to reignite the ability for students to imagine and dream beyond what has been encouraged in our moment. One quick example, one time I was in, sometimes when I ask young students, what are your dreams of the future? Oftentimes those dreams are very individualistic and materialistic. It's about an individual with an courage to say, I have to get mine, I have to get my job, and I'm only here to get my diploma, to get my check, to get blah, 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 blah. We don't even, and my point is, we're not even encouraged to dream about something beyond that, to just fantasize and use our imagination to think of a world that might potentially one day exist that doesn't require such individualistic pursuit. Just want to remind everybody where we are.
It's a dynamic museum, a national mall where people can learn about Reverend King, so many other things. Frederick Douglass is an example of somebody who's done an easy job as being recognized in modern writings. Harriet Tubman, Rosa Parks, and millions more Black Americans who made America what it is today. Big impact. I'm proud to honor this heritage, and we'll be honoring it more and more folks at the table. In almost all cases of the good friends and supporters.
I just want to have a little bit there because he references Douglass and does so in a way that is somewhat terrifying. But in the same sense, I don't want anybody to be terrified of this guy. He is, in fact, bringing in some dangerous policies and dangerous people, and his ignorance is displayed here is, in fact, dangerous. But I don't want what I feel like is encouraged in this moment, that we be scared into inaction or terrified into silence. In fact, we should be more bold, more aggressive, more hostile to that kind of thinking, to that kind of ignorance. In fact, Douglass himself made the point that education and slavery were incompatible with each other. And as I would like to argue, one reason that he was left out of the film Lincoln, and why somebody like Sophie Carmichael and Kwame Ture was left out of the film Selma, is because both spoke to a theme we've not still fully grasped. We are not free, and nor will we be until the institutions that produce society are forcibly and radically changed or discarded. Just as the conveyor belt, as we saw in that video, a conveyor belt education mass produces consciousness, so too do political and media systems of production mass produce consent. Similarly, Douglass, this is what Douglass said about the 13th Amendment, which, as you see here, if you can read it at all, if you haven't read it for yourself, clearly does not abolish slavery. In fact, it codifies and makes it legal and only requires a conviction of a crime first. But back when it was passed, one of the reasons, again, why you don't see Douglass even mentioned in that popular film Lincoln, which was supposed to be about the 13th Amendment, is because of this quote here. Slavery has been fruitful in giving itself names. It has been called a peculiar institution, the social system, the impediment, as it was called by the General Conference of the Methodist Episcopal Church. It has been called by a great many names, and will call itself by yet another name, and you and I and all of us had better wait to see what new form this old monster will assume, in what new skin this old state will come forth. As many have argued, and I just want to echo that in a few minutes and just quickly I have remaining, that extended or rebranded slavery is manifested not only in mass incarceration, but in a continued and worsening material inequality that Black people continue to suffer in this country. In this most latest report, which compares the condition of Black America to where we were in 1968, the State of the Dream reports, as they call them, it's showing here yet again, we are devolved. 80% of the wealth that was held last year was inherited. This idea that you can go out and go from poverty to wealth and achieve the American dream is in fact mythology. The overall wealth gap in the United States has widened significantly in the past 30 years, with the richest 1% now owning 41% of the wealth. For every dollar owned by the average white family in the U.S., the average family of color has less than a dime. That's 2017. And it's worse than even that. We just don't have that much time. In January 28, 1967, I went back and looked at this. One of my favorite people, already mentioned Stoker Carmichael, who changed the department to where he came to this very university and spoke to students, encouraging them in a way I would go to a to get involved radically with the movements that are going on around him. That's why I started with that song. All of what he said in the interview, his highlights are exactly still relevant today. He spoke of dishonest media, what we're now calling today fake news. He spoke of global unrest, uprisings, and even more distinct students to engage that struggle. Look what's happening all around the world. People are uprising all over the place. He spoke of Frederick Douglass being enslaved right here in Maryland, fighting for his freedom, and that the rest he reminded students of Douglass' still relevant statement that power concedes nothing without a demand. It never has and never will. He said that the power to define is the most important power we have. The power to define what we mean by race, gender, citizenship, etc. He said that the problem with our students is that they do not read enough. That I don't have. Our students don't read enough. But I would argue most of us don't read enough. I don't read enough. We need to read more. He talked about the permanence of a war economy and that nearly all the federal budget went to feeding a war. If you look at what the late war Vidalgo said about the federal budget of this country, 90% is actually used for war, for the Pentagon, for feeding a war machine. What might that mean? Any of that would be directly to get at free schools, healthcare, education, housing. He talked about relating wars overseas to the conditions of black people in the ghetto in Baltimore to the uprisings coming from those communities all over the country. I mean, we just saw it. We're living it. In 2017, 2016, he then concluded that there was a need for this generation to become involved in humankind. And I'm going to echo that sentiment. We have to become more involved in our global and uprising radical communities. Finally, the late great Franz Fanon said, to this point about crushing the dreams, that the settlers' work is to make any dreams of liberty impossible for the native, and the native's work is to imagine all possible methods for destroying the settler. Without our ability to imagine, to dream of a world that doesn't currently exist, we cannot overturn and abolish the structures, these settler structures that continue to bind us. So just in finally, the conclusion, I just want to leave you with the question of how are you going to aid the ongoing struggle for positive peace, justice, and redistribution of goods and services and the wealth that we all produce. We all produce the wealth that is currently held by 1% of the population of the world who currently have more wealth than 99% of the rest of us combined. But we are producing that wealth. They're just taking it and living off of it. What are we all going to do to get involved in the struggle? And with that, I thank everybody for having me. It's been a pleasure to send to you guys as peace if you're willing to fight for it. So peace is here. Thank you.
preached by Layla Anderson, I opened my mouth to the Lord.
Thank you. purpose. And the meditation is an adaptation from one of the great clerics in American history, leader of Baba Harapuram. Listen to what he admonishes us as a people. May God open to us light for our hearts. May God open for us courage for our fears. May God open for us hope for our despair. May God open for us peace for our turmoil. May God open for us joy for our sorrows, strength for our weaknesses, wisdom for our confusion, forgiveness for our sins, tenderness for our toughness, love for our hate. May God open to us thyself for ourselves. Lord, Lord, continue to open for us the courage to be. Amen.
We would like to thank everybody.